Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you share it with a friend. God wanted to move Daniel to the top echelon of the Babylonian government, and he used Nebuchadnezzar's dream to orchestrate Daniel's rise to power. The king had a dream and he forgot what he dreamt, and the court magicians could only offer to provide an interpretation because their gods were limited. God revealed the dream to Daniel, and he recounted it in its entirety to the king. God had elevated Nebuchadnezzar, and there would be an additional three kingdoms after his death. Nebuchadnezzar was suitably impressed, but the prophetic message went over his head. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm going to be speaking today about the four kingdoms that was prophesied by the prophet Daniel. And some people say, why are you spending time in the Old Testament and why should we go through this in detail? And the answer is, if you want to know how God thinks, how God has done, walked and done in the past, then study the records and you will find out, you can know what God has said, what he will do in the future. With that, let's pray. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you and praise you right now that I'm going to be able to share this message, Father God. And I just ask you, help me to be anointed. Just anoint me, Father God, and speak through me. And I pray for each one watching and listening that they will be able to hear and understand and to apply it to their personal lives. And this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let's talk about the prophets. The Godhead decided that two main prophets would be active during the Babylonian captivity. Daniel and his seeker would deliver short-term prophecies, but the main prophecies would span thousands of years into the future. The prophecies were supplied to men with no knowledge of electricity, combustion engines, airplanes, radio, television, satellites, and instant global communication. There were no afforded technical explanations. As a result, they were forced to use limited knowledge and the vocabulary that they had. On top of this, they were given no specific dates. Nevertheless, the prophecy was so detailed that when it came close to being fulfilled, that generation would instantly understand what was going to happen. So I'm going to take and turn to the book of Daniel right now. And we're going to look upon chapter 2. We're going to start in verse number 1. So that's Daniel chapter 2 and verse number 1. So let me lay the background here. The first prophecy that we're going to look upon here in the book of Daniel was given to King Nebuchadnezzar and interpreted by Daniel. The Godhead could have given it directly to Daniel, but they wanted to use the dream to establish Daniel as a prophet and elevate him within the Babylonian government. The dream was so troubling to Nebuchadnezzar that he could not return to sleep or remember what he dreamt. He demanded for the soothsayers and magicians to recount his dream and provide the interpretation. Since they were idol worshippers and empowered by demons, they could not help the king with a message from the Lord. Nebuchadnezzar decided to execute them when he discovered how worthless and they were. Unfortunately, this imperial command also included Daniel, and his three friends. So let's read the story right now from Daniel chapter 2 and verse number 1. And in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams, wherewith his spirit was troubled, and his sleep brake from him. Then the king commanded to call the magicians, and the astrologers, and the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans, for to show the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king. And the king said unto them, I have dreamed a dream. My spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syriac, O king, live forever. Tell your servants a dream, and we will show you the interpretation. These men were part of the occult. They were powered by Satan, his demons, and they could not give an interpretation. They needed to know, what did Nebuchadnezzar dream? The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me. If you will not make known to me the dream with interpretation thereof, you should be cut in pieces and your houses should be made a dunghill. God has set us up in such a way that Nebuchadnezzar knew he had a dream. It troubled him, but he could not remember it. But still, he was troubled. Then he said this, but if you show the dream and interpretation of, you shall receive of me gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore, show me the dream and the interpretation thereof. The people from the occult, the soothsayers, the witches and so on, Chaldeans, they answered and said, let the king tell his servant the dream. We will show the interpretation of it. The king answered and said, I know of a certainty that you would gain the time because you see the thing is gone from me. But if you not make known unto me the dream, there is but one decree for you. For you have prepared lying and corrupt words to speak before me till the time be changed. Therefore tell me the dream. I shall know that you can show me the interpretation thereof. He called them liars. He simply said, you are lying. The Chaldeans answered before the king and said, there is not a man upon the earth that can show the king's matter. Therefore, there is no king, lord, nor ruler that asks such things of any magicians or astrologer or Chaldean. And it's a rare thing that the king requires. There is none other can show it before the king except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. They simply said, this can only be done supernaturally from the spirit world. The king responded now, for this cause the king was angry, very furious, and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. And the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain. Now, here is Daniel now. He was not present when this took place in front of the Nebuchadnezzar at the throne room. And Daniel said this in verse 14. Then Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom to Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, which was gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon. He answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain, why is this decree so hasty from the king? Then Arioch made the thing known to Daniel. Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time and that he would show the king the interpretation. In verse number 16, we can see the courage of Daniel. He simply said, let me go in and talk to the king. Now, the king had been furious, and he simply said, I'm going to talk to him. Then Daniel went in and desired the king that he would give him time, and it would show the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house and made a thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they would desire mercies of the God of heaven concerning the secret, that Daniel's fellow should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Daniel did not know and understand exactly what God was doing. So he did not know the outcome for the future. But he had faith that if he prayed and if he asked God, God would give him the interpretation. There was a secret revealed unto Daniel in night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changed the times and the seasons. He removed kings and set up kings. He gives wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. He reveals the deep and secret thing. He knows what is in our darkness, and the light dwells with him. I thank you and praise you, O you God of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might, and made known unto me now what we desired of you. For you have now made known unto us the king's matter. I want you to see the faith now. This is what we really should learn something from. Daniel had received an interpretation. He had received and been told by the Holy Spirit what the dream was about. But the question would have come, is this the correct interpretation? He knew that the king was furious. If Daniel did not have all the points lined up, the king would know it. He would remember the dream. And Daniel would be a dead man. Therefore, Daniel went in unto Arioch, whom the king had ordained to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and said unto him, destroy not the wise men of Babylon. Bring me in before the king, and I will show unto the king the interpretation. Daniel could have simply said, this is my opportunity to wipe out the intelligentsia, the people that are standing before the king and giving me advice, and I can be the ruler under the king. But Daniel knew that he needed support, and that the Chaldeans, the soothsayers, they would be thankful to Daniel for having saved their lives. And thus, they would be his allies, not his enemies. Then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king in haste, and said thus unto him, I have found a man on the capital of Judah that will make known unto the king the interpretation. The king answered and said to Daniel, name was Belteshazzar, are you able to make known unto me the dream which I have seen and the interpretation thereof? He said, are you sure that you can do this? Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret with the king has demanded cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers show unto the king. But there is a God in heaven that reveals secrets and make known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. Your dream and a vision of your head upon your bed are these. Can you see now the king sitting on a throne, intently watching Daniel? And listening, it must have been very quiet in the throne room. And then Daniel said this. As for you, O king, your thought came into your mind upon your bed, which will come to pass hereafter. And he that reveals secrets makes known to you what shall come to pass. But as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have more than any living, but for their sake, and shall make known the interpretation of the king, and that you might know the thought of your heart. Thou, O king, sawest, and behold a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before you, and the form thereof was terrible. The image's head was of fire, was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thigh of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. You saw that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet. They were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation therefore before the king. Now, here's interpretation. You, a king, are a king and kings, for the God of heaven has given you a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. And wherever the children of men dwell, the beast and the field and the fowls of the heaven, has he given into your hand, has made you ruler over them all. You are this head of gold. And after you shall arise another kingdom, inferior to you, another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be strong of iron, for as much as iron breaks in pieces and subdue all things, and as iron that breaks these shall he break in pieces and bruise. And whereas you saw the feet and toes part of potter's clay and part of iron, and the kingdom shall be divided, but it shall be in the strength of the iron, for as much as you saw the iron mixed with the mire of clay. And as the toes of feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. And whereas you saw iron mixed with mire of clay, he shall mingle himself with the seed of men, but it shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. For as much as you saw that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, that he break in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter, and the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof sure. Daniel then stopped. Nebuchadnezzar was stunned. Exactly what he had seen in the dream, Daniel had described. He'd also given him an interpretation. Then the king, Nebuchadnezzar, fell upon his face and worshipped Daniel. This was unheard of, that the king would fall on the floor and simply give worship to a man. Nebuchadnezzar knew this. This man has power from God, and I need to acknowledge this God. And he worshipped Daniel and commanded that they should offer an oblation and sweet odors unto him. The king answered to Daniel and said, of a truth, it is, that your God is a God of gods and the Lord of kings, a revealer of secrets, seeing that you could reveal his secret. Then the king made Daniel a great man and gave him many great gifts and made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon, chief of the governors of all the wise men of Babylon. Then Daniel requested of the king, and he said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego over the affairs of the province of Babylon. But Daniel sat in the gate of the king, and the gate here means the throne room. Daniel became second to Nebuchadnezzar. If you look on the outline here right now, we've given you some historical facts here. Nebuchadnezzar became king in 605 B.C. He ruled for 43 years until 562 B.C. The Babylonian kingdom would last another 23 years until it was conquered by King Cyrus of Persia in 539. The Persian kingdom lasted to 334 B.C., a total of 205 years, until it was conquered by Greece. Alexander the Great took control of the Greek city-states, invaded Persia in 334 B.C. He enlarged the kingdom during the next 10 years and expanded to India by 326 B.C. Alexander's empire spanned from Greece to the west, the entire Middle East, with the nations of Afghanistan, Pakistan, and chunks of India under his control. He returned to Babylon, which he planned to use as the capital, but Alexander's dream was cut short when he died in 323 B.C. at the age of 33. These were three kingdoms. Now, the layers of the statue were as follows. The golden head, which was Babylon, the chest and arms of silver, which was Persia, the stomach and the things of brass, which was Greece, the legs of iron, the feet being a mixture of iron and clay. Today, most people think that was Rome. I disagree with them. Let's talk about the fourth kingdom. There's been much speculation about the fourth kingdom. The majority of Christian scholars claim that it was the Roman Empire, and I held the same view for many years because it was prevalent among Southern Baptists. But a closer examination of the prophecy shows that the description of the fourth kingdom does not fit the Roman Empire. The only kingdom that fits is the one of the Antichrist is going to rule prior to the second coming of Christ. Steel is a strong alloy delivered from iron that has been discovered by the ancient world. But at this time, iron was the strongest metal known at that time, and Daniel used to describe the strength of this fourth kingdom. It will subdue all things, including people and finances. The details with the Apostle John's description in in the book of Revelation. Let's look upon Daniel 2:40 again. And it says this, and the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron. For as much as iron breaks in pieces and subdues all things, as iron that breaks all these, they shall break in pieces and bruise. If we turn now to Revelation chapter 13, that will be the book of Revelation and chapter 13. And we're going to pick it up here from verse number 7 and 8. And it was given to him to make war with the saints, to overcome them, and power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life, or the Lamb slain for the foundation of the world. And then in verses 16 and 17, we read this. And he, that's a false prophet, causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand and their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had a mark of the name of the beast, and the number of his name. Notice now that when Daniel was given his prophecy, it was about 590 B.C. in that time frame. The book of Revelation had not even yet been written, had not been given to the Apostle John. But the prophecy here from Daniel, and later confirmed by Jesus through the Apostle John, simply states that we're going to have here a strong kingdom that would simply rule the world. The fourth kingdom would be divided but held together by the iron. In contrast, John described the 10 kings, 10 toes, which would give power to the Antichrist. So Daniel 2, 41 and 42, we read, and of the toes of the feet were part of iron, part of clay, that the kingdom partly strong and partly broken. Now, if we look upon Revelation chapter 17 and the verses 11 and 13, and the beast that was and is not, even is the eighth, is of the seven, goes into perdition. And the 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but received power as kings, 1 hour with the beast. If we now look upon the outline here, I want to discuss Daniel chapter 2, verse 43. God did not tell Daniel, whom he's referring to in verse 43. It makes not sense by itself. Jesus would not reveal, Jesus would later reveal that by the end times would be just like the days of Noah, when fallen angels procreated with human women to produce a hybrid race. In this verse, the angels would be the iron, mankind would be the clay, and the two would mix, but the cohesion would not be very strong. The angels were aware that the things which Daniel did understand and told the prophet, that knowledge would increase over time, and that God's people will be enlightened toward the end. If you turn to Daniel chapter 12 right now, that's the book of Daniel again, chapter 12, and we're going to look in verses 4 through 9. But you, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Then I, Daniel, looked, and behold, there stood other two, the one on the side of the bank of the river, the other on the side of the bank of the river. And one said to the man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, how long shall it be to the end of these wonders? And I heard a man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, when he held up his right hand, his left hand unto heaven, and swear by him that live forever, that it shall be for a time, times and a half, and when he shall accomplish to scatter the power of the holy people, and these things shall be finished. And I heard, but understood not. Then said I, O my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? And he said, go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed to the end of times. Daniel realized that he had seen something in the future. He didn't understand the details. And I believe that God purposely gave the certain information to Daniel, but other things were withheld, which will be later in time revealed. If you turn on to Matthew chapter 24, that's the Gospel of Matthew, the 24th chapter. We're going to pick it up here in verses 37 through 39. Jesus said, "But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage unto the day that Noah entered in the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." If we look now in the outline, I wrote this. Fallen angels procreated with human women and their offspring were called giants or Nephilims. This was now before the flood of Noah. We were also told that the animal kingdom and plant life was corrupted, genetically changed, and that all flesh on the earth had been changed from its original form. Let's turn to Genesis chapter 6. That is Genesis chapter 6, and we're going to pick it up in the verse 1. Genesis 6 and verse 1. "And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he is also flesh, that his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. And God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." And then verse 11, "The earth also was corrupt before God. The earth was filled with violence. And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted its ways unto the earth." Mankind has learned about DNA. Daniel did not know about DNA. Matter of fact, when I went to seminary, DNA, this was in 1969, DNA was not known. I remember the professors were arguing and saying that, you know, the virgin birth of Mary was impossible and that she was not made impregnant by the Holy Spirit, and we should not preach that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit. 10, 15 years later, DNA was discovered. And not only that, but doctors were able to take and fertilize it. They take an egg out of a woman, fertilize it outside, put it back in, and she would have be pregnant, and there would be a child to be born. So there's a lot of things that we have learned technically that now helps us to understand the book of Daniel and also the book of Revelation. Here's what I said on the outline here on page number 3. According to Jesus, fallen angels would once again mingle with the human race and create a hybrid man-angel just like the days of Noah. There are modern reports of men and women who have been abducted and medically examined in UFOs. Women have been impregnated by beings on UFOs and given birth to babies. Stories like these have been brushed aside and rejected, but there have been too many sightings and testimonies which agree with the Bible. If we go back again to Daniel, and we look in 2:43, that's Daniel chapter 2 and verse number 43. It is a powerful verse. And it says this, "And whereas you saw iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. But they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay." Here we have now, "They shall mingle themselves with the seed of men." We have now a crossover for the spirit world, where again, during the time of the Antichrist, fallen angels will again mingle themselves, create some type of bodies, and have sex with women. And they would create a race, a hybrid, just like we had before the flood. Let's talk about the second coming of Jesus. In Daniel 2:34, Daniel is not given a prophecy about Jesus. "You saw till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet, that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, and the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth." This is a vision, a prophetic vision of Jesus that would come. Now, we have that description of how it is going to happen. And if you turn again to the book of Revelation, and we're going to look now to chapter 19. That's Revelation chapter 19. And we're going to pick it up in verse number 11. This is what Jesus told the Apostle John about 90 A.D. "And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire. On his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but himself. He was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of the mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he shall smite the nations. He shall root them with a rod of iron. He treadeth a winepress of fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his vesture, on his thigh, a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, Come and gather yourself together to the supper of the great King, that you may eat the flesh of kings and the flesh of captains and the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast and the king of the earth and the armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. And the beast was taken, with him the false prophet that wrote miracles before him, would deceive them that received the mark of the beast, and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire, burning with brimstone. And the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeds out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh." That little stone, Jesus, when Jesus comes back the second time, he's not going to come as a savior. He's going to come as a king. He's going to have angelic armies with him. The enemy will be crushed, destroyed. The kingdom of Satan, the Antichrist, will be destroyed and shall never be again. Let's look upon page 4 of the outline right now. The Godhead paused the virtual time room to discuss how the people on earth had Enoch's writings and the 6 chapters of Genesis, which chronicle the time before Noah's flood. If God's people read these 2 sources and apply them to the prophecy of Daniel, they would understand that the end times would be similar to the time before Noah's flood. This goes against everything that the Christian church is teaching today. In the Christian church in the 21st century, the spirit world has been relegated to not exist anymore. And for pastors today to begin to teach about spiritual things, things for the spirit world, what's going to happen in the future, is foreign to them. And the reason for that is that they've been trained in the seminaries, that the Holy Spirit is no longer here. He left. The gift of the Holy Spirit are gone. All we have is a Bible, and basically the Christian church is nothing more than an organization that is simply powered by people. The Godhead also realized that the devil had no intention of allowing people to be educated on the subject and will use his power to ensure that people remained ignorant of what Daniel had told. The Godhead also knew that if they had released too much technology to humanity, it would be difficult for the Redeemer in the future, because mankind could simply explain away the miracles with advances in science and medicine. They recognized that only a remnant of the human race would be saved and brought to heaven. And that brings us to the closing scripture for today, and that is in Matthew chapter 7. That's Matthew chapter 7. And we're going to look in verses 13 and 14. Enter you into the straight gate. And the word straight here, the old interpretation of that, or the meaning of that, means a narrow, a small gate. Enter you in the straight, small gate. For wide is a gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be that go in thereof. Because straight, narrow is a gate, and narrow is a way which leads unto life, and few there be that find it. If we look back on the history of man for the last 6,000 years, it is obvious that I would say 95%, if not even 97 or 98% of all people who have lived on this earth for the last 6,000 years died without knowing God, without knowing about the Redeemer, without knowing about Jesus. And they went straight to hell. These prophecies that we discussed here today should simply put some fear into you. If this is true, it's a miracle I'm saved. I should really be praising God that I know Jesus, that I have received Christ as my Savior, that I'm forgiven, that I have eternal life. Few people would have that chance. And yet most Christians who are born again, they do not even think and praise God for it. They just pray, God, I need this, I need this, I need more of this and more of that. We should simply stop and say, what a tragedy that the majority of humans will live in hell and later in the lake of fire forever and ever. If you are watching and you are an unbeliever and you have never met Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, this is your opportunity right now to simply say, I believe there is a God. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for me. And through his death and resurrection, I can be saved. God, forgive me. Jesus, come into my life and save me right now. When we finish here, you will find the screen will be changing. And there will be three crosses coming up. Pastor Charles will come forward. You will not see him, but hear his voice. And for 10 minutes, he will explain to you in detail what salvation is, how to get saved, how to pray, and how to get born. I pray to God that you take that opportunity today and that you will receive Christ and be born again, and you will be among the few that will make it to heaven. To those of you that are saved and walking with Christ, and you might say, what should I take away from this message? Here's what you should take away. There is a spirit world. It's real. Matter of fact, the spirit world, it's just as real as a physical world. The spirit world has always existed, always will exist, and we're going to transfer into the spirit world when we die. And the new heavens and the new earth is going to be in the spirit world. We should look upon these prophecies and say, wow, some 590 years before Christ, Daniel received information about the very end times. And then the Apostle John received additional information. And by taking the two of them, we now have a picture of what's going to happen in the near future. Maybe 5, 10, 15, 20 years from now. And it's going to happen exactly like it has been described in the Bible. Study these prophecies. Master them so that you can teach them, understand it. And when things are going to beginning to break and things are going bad, you can simply say, this is prophesied. It's nothing new. God told us this is the way it's going to come down. We need that assurance so that when things go bad, when the Antichrist comes, we will not melt. May God bless you as you simply make a decision to stand, to study, and to proclaim the news about Jesus to the day that you pass. Let's pray. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you and praise you right now for these few minutes here that we had to discuss the vision of Daniel and also the book of Revelation. And I pray right now, Father God, that you will save a number of people as they watch this video. And that many Christians, Father God, would simply stop and say, we need to study this. We need to get sharp. Help them, Father God, to be soul winners. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner.
This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that You would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in You. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that You paid for my sins on the cross through Your shed blood, and that You died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank You for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with You. Help me to be obedient and to walk with You. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 69th part in the series, The Origin Story of Jesus, and was entitled, The Four Kingdoms. God wanted to move Daniel to the top echelon of the Babylonian government, and He used Nebuchadnezzar's dream to orchestrate Daniel's rise to power. It started with a dream that the king forgot. The court magicians offered to provide an interpretation, but their gods were powerless to reveal the dream. Not so with Daniel's God. He revealed the dream and its meaning to Daniel. God had elevated Nebuchadnezzar, and there would be an additional three kingdoms after his death. Babylon was the first kingdom, the second was Persia, and the third was Greece. Many have claimed that the fourth kingdom was Rome, but Daniel's words reveal this can't be the case. What we have instead is the first reference to the global kingdom of the Antichrist with a nod back to the way it was during the days of Noah. Jesus is the rock that will smash the statue and break the fourth kingdom. Nebuchadnezzar was impressed with Daniel's God, but the prophetic message went over his head. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1864. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.